honorable rabbis, community leaders, and guests, welcome to a historic lecture, Out of the Depth, with Rabbi Israel Meir Lau. I'd like to begin with thanking the Hillel Yeshiva for hosting us this evening. I'd like to thank our co-sponsor, the Jewish Federation of the Heart of New Jersey, Change, the Ideal Life. I'd like to thank Sammy and Margie Saka and family for helping sponsor this evening. Thank you. We stand here tonight a few short days after Tisha B'Av. Tisha B'Av, we mourn the destruction of the first temple and the second temple, the first Beis HaMikdash and the second Beis HaMikdash. But we're told, Jewish tradition tells us that on Tisha B'Av, in addition to mourning the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, the temple, we mourn all the loss and destruction that the Jewish people experienced throughout history. It is so appropriate that the event tonight takes place a few days after Tisha B'Av, because Jewish tradition tells us that after Tisha B'Av, we focus on the future, we focus on hope, we focus on rebuilding. The prophet Jeremiah says in the verse, "Esari hiliyako umimena yivashaya." It's a time of trouble for Jacob, for the Jewish people, and from it, and after, will come help and salvation. The holy Baal Shem Tov says that the verse has a deeper meaning. A Sarei Liyakov, it's a troubled time for Jacob. It's a time of sadness, loss, and pain. Umimena, and from the pain, from the loss, comes salvation and help. The salvation and help just doesn't only follow after the tragedy. The Holy Baal Shem Tov says that the hope and healing comes from the tragedy, from the loss. The Baal Shem Tov continues, the Baal Shem Tov says, we all are familiar with the word tsara, tsaris, troubles, problems, pain, loss. If you rearrange the word, if you rearrange the letters, you have the beautiful and powerful word of tsohar. Light, like the light that Noah had in his ark. The Torah says that Noah had tsohar, had a stone that was a source of light. So the Baal Shem Tov says, if we rearrange tsar, pain, loss, and suffering, if you look deep inside, you can find light, hope, and strength. Tonight, we have the great honor of hearing from Rabbi Lau, who took tsar, who took pain, loss and destruction, and made light and became a source of light for so many. Rabbi Lau is a source of strength and hope and belief for the Jewish community. Rabbi Lau's belief in Hashem, dedication to the future of Judaism, is an inspiration to all of us. I want to thank Rabbi Lau and Riveting Drama for honoring the Jewish community of Monmouth County and spending this weekend with us. Thank you so much. From the many things that we could all learn from Rabbi Lau is to recognize our own personal tzar, collectively as a community, but each one in our personal life, our pain, our challenges. Learn from Rabbi Lau to turn it into tzohar, into a source of light and strength. At this time, I would like to ask the Rosh Yeshiva of Hillel Yeshiva, the Rabbi of Congregation Magen David, Rabbi Kasson, to share a few words.
Tonight, it is my distinct honor and privilege to welcome Cheif Rabbi Meir Lau to our community. Rabbi Lau, I want you to know that the last time I heard you speak live was at the Siyum Hashas at MetLife Stadium 5 years ago, almost exactly to the day. It was Parashat Vayetchanan then, Shabbat Nachamu, as it is this week. The Siyum Hashas, for those that are unfamiliar, is a celebration of the completion of the study of the entire Babylonian Talmud, all 63 tractates, one page a day over the course of more than 7 years. There were close to 100,000 people there at the stadium that night. And Rabbi, your message on that Wednesday night was from the designated song of the day taken from Tehillim chapter 29. El Nekamot Adonai, El Nekamot Tofia. O God of vengeance, Hashem, O God of vengeance, appear. That psalm was a prayer of Moshe Rabbeinu, and it was a prayer that God should appear in the future and punish the proud and cruel nations that tormented us. And Rabbi, you pointed out that that night, God's vengeance was manifest in that giant stadium and all over the world, as Jews from all walks and all circles finished the Talmud in unison, and we have continued to study the Luwad Torah despite our enemies' attempts to wipe us out. You reminded the crowd that night that 67 years after the horrific atrocities of the Holocaust, this was our greatest revenge. Your words of inspiration that night were felt throughout. But Rabbi, with your permission, I would like to add to your words of that evening. The continuation of that Tehillim reads, Mi yakum li imereim, mi yasir li po'ala'avim. Who will rise up for me against evildoers? Who will stand up for me against the workers of iniquity? And the answer the Tehillim writes, Lule Hashem ezratali kemat shachena zuma nafshi. Had Hashem not been a help to me, my soul would have dwelt in silence. Of course, it's the master of the universe himself who stands up for us. But Hashem also has his shilichim. God has his messengers in this world. And you, Rabbi Lau, represent one of those messengers of hope that rise up and stand for us against our enemies. You are our greatest symbol. You are Hashem appearing to us as Kel Nekamot Tofia. You see, the words Mi Yakum Li, who will stand for me, the Rashi Tevot of those words are Mem Yud Lamed, which is Yisrael Meir Lau. And the words Mi Yaseh Li, who will stand up for me, those Rashi Tevot are Mem Yud Lamed, which stands for Yisrael Meir Lau. Rabbi, you are our beacon of light. Your presence alone here tonight gives us chizuk. It gives us great encouragement as a people. We look forward tonight to your inspiring words, and we pray to Hashem, as you just celebrated your 80th birthday, which the Mishnah tells us represents Givurah, strength, that he grant you continued strength to be his loyal messenger for our great nation. Ad biyad Mashiach kenu b'mara b'yadenu. Amen.
Chief Rabbi Israel Meir Lau is the former Chief Ashkenazi Rabbi of Israel and a world-renowned speaker, lecturer, and advocate for the Jewish people. Rabbi Lau emerged from the ashes of the Holocaust to become one of Israel's greatest leaders. The Buchenwald survivor tended to a generation of orphans, and today his story of hope, heroism, and renewal is a source of inspiration for many across Israel and the world. Rabbi Lau enjoyed a uniquely close relationship with the beloved Rebbe that spanned from Rabbi Lau's early days in the rabbinate until he was appointed as chief rabbi and charged with addressing the religious needs of all of Israel. Currently the chief rabbi of Tel Aviv and chairman of the Yad Vashem Council, Rabbi Lau is recognized globally as one of Israel's leading figures and a foremost authority on Judaism. Chabad is honored to welcome Cheif Rabbi Lau.
The last one is the Russian language. The English is somewhere in the middle. French, Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, Turkish. One of the letters showed me you did very well by telling the story. This is a letter from someone I didn't know, in Hebrew. He said, he wrote, "You don't know me, now I do know you. I am a soldier from the Lebanese battle in the Second Lebanese War. I was the hardest injured soldier of the Northern battlefield, and I found myself from Lebanon in the Rambam Hospital in Haifa. And I arrived here from the hospital. I had passed 7 operations. I'm 21 years old. I feel like 200 years. And I'm tired of life. Tired. And no energy anymore to suffer. It's pain. The most difficult operation took 6-7 hours. The day after, the head of the surgery department of my Maimonides Hospital in Haifa asked my parents to come, and he told them, "I'm very sorry, we failed. The operation didn't succeed. The life of your son is now in the danger more than ever before." And my father said, "This is the last chance." The professor said, "No, there is one small chance, a very little bit of hope. If he will repeat the same operation." Now we know exactly what we have mistaken. Now we know exactly these problems all around. If he will sign, because he's already 21 years old, not a baby, if he will sign that he accepts another operation, we give him some chance to live. Not 50%, much less. He tells me all in this letter, a soldier I never met. My parents came to me, to my bed, telling the whole story very honestly, very frankly. And I said, "Take it away, the phone. I will not sign. I'm not going on another operation. I'm tired. I'm exhausted. Leave me alone. Leave me to die." Enough. 21 years, I did mine. I started to give you a little bit of nachas from me. That's what I can. I cannot do it. I cried, my mother, my father. A few days later was my birthday, 21st birthday. They brought all the family, from far as from near, with balloons in my room in the hospital. For me it was a separate part. I looked at everyone in his eyes, I wanted to catch his eyes, and I understood this is the last time that I see this cousin, that aunt, their auntie, my brother, my sister. They brought the gifts, they sang, "Happy birthday to you, happy birthday." and it is a happy birthday for me to us to separate my relatives. I couldn't sleep that night after the party. 3 o'clock a.m. I found something in my bed, hard. I pulled it. It was a book. I looked at the front of the book, the front cover. Al tishlach yadcha el hanar. Don't raise your hand against the boy. Take it from Binding of Isaac. Written by Rav Yisrael Meir Lau. I knew you from the television, sometimes from the radio, from your talks, but we never met. And I wondered, why did they bring me a gift for my birthday? A story about the Holocaust? A story about the rabbi? I'm not an observant boy. These are my parents. This is a gift for my birthday, a Holocaust, a rabbi. But I couldn't sleep, so I started to read. And I read, and I read, and I read. 1 o'clock p.m., 10 hours later, I finished the book. I couldn't eat. I couldn't sleep. I didn't speak to anyone, but I was reading the book 10 hours. When I finished the book, reading, I cried out, Ima! Mother! She was in the corridor. She jumped into my room. Why am I screaming? What happens? She thought that this is the last moment. What happens to you? Give me the form I want to sign that I am going to the new operation. Bring me the form. Bring it quickly before I change my mind. She was running, brought back the form, and before I signed, she said to me, may I ask you what happened? What changed your mind? I lifted up from my bed your book. I said, this changed my decision. If this rabbi, who I never met, could overcome all those difficulties, could overcome all the obstacles in his life, and to be what he is, with an optimism, with a smile, I felt ashamed how egoistic I felt last days. I did nothing for you to make you happy. My father and my mother, we had no parents in my age. And I have you. And you asked me so nice, please sign. You cried here near my bed 3 days ago. And I refused. How could I refuse to my mother? I will say. The end of the letter is, I made that operation. It succeeded. Tomorrow, I leave the hospital. After a few months, and I'm going back home. Before I leave the hospital, I found a need to write this letter to thank the book which saved my life. Thank you. I came with this letter from my office home to my wife, tears in my eyes, and I said, Hayakadai, it was worth it. To go back to the hell 60 years earlier, because of the life of one Jewish soldier from Haifa, who I never met. But this book saved his life. that if he could overcome all the obstacles, what can I say? And I am surrounded with such a family. They came to my party, my birthday. I cannot disappoint. I must make the operation. And he succeeded. One of the stories brought to the book that I find that this is the message. My eyes in the whole. What a chapter, what a sentence, or a word of the Holy Bible, of our holy tradition, what a part, a small part of our rich heritage is worth it, is valuable. This is the story. We were liberated in Buchenwald, concentration camp in East North Germany, near the city of Weimar, city of culture, literature in the Germany. We were liberated by the American army, led by General Patton, on April 11, 1945. I was less than 8 years old. Only after the liberation I discovered that my brother, Naftali, let his memory be blessed, 11 years older, was also in Buchenwald. He couldn't meet, he was in a different barrack, and he lost consciousness. He didn't know about the liberation. Only a few days later, when he woke up, 3 days he was not in this world anymore. That's what we find. The whole family. Father, mother, grandparents, a brother between Naftali and me was in the age of 13. He went to the guest chamber together with my father in Treblinka. They took us to France. 5 weeks after the liberation, we were on a train going to a sanatorium, 90 kilometers from Paris. There is a very small village called Ecouille. In that sanatorium, held by Jewish welfare organizations, with some private Jewish people. There was a lady born and born in Lodz, Mrs. Rachel Nitz. She was for us like the mother of the children. We were 220 boys, some from Bergen-Belsen and we from Buchenwald. She translated from French to Polish. She was a psychologist, like a mother to each of us. We spent there about a month. Once upon a day, in the lunch, the dining room, she stood up and said, "Boys, I have a request. Do me a favor. 4 o'clock in the afternoon, exactly 4 o'clock, we have to welcome some visitors, some personalities like the mayor of Ecouille, the head of the police here, the head of the army in this region, and some leaders of the Jewish community in France. 4 o'clock exactly, I want you to be there on the grass in the center of the village. All of you, please be there." Those people supported the senator. We didn't know exactly the details, but one of us, elderly group, stood up and said, "Panami in Soma, Mrs. Mintz, we will not be there. Forget about it." Now they come, Meir, the head of the police, the head of the army. Where were they 6 years? They kept silent. A few weeks that we are after the war, after our liberation, we have received, we have got some knowledge, some information. What did they do from 39 to 45, the 6 years of Holocaust? Almost nothing. It was a very small group in France called Maquis, the underground movement. Very few. But the millions opened their arms and the gates to Hitler and the Nazis. We have nothing with them. We will not judge them. We are not in power to do it. But we have no will to meet with them. Now they come. When they slaughtered our parents, they didn't say a word. Now they come to take pictures with Holocaust children. It's a nice picture. An orphanage, a young boy, shaking hands with him. We will not do it. Mrs. Min said, boys, I will tell you a secret. It's confidential, but I must tell you. Every one of you will receive from them, from the guests, a gift, a small package. And on this package will be printed the name of each of you. They asked me the names because they want to give you a gift. By the way, the gift was sabon, toothpaste, a toothbrush. You can receive it in the airplane sometimes. But this was the letter. We didn't ask what is the present. The name will be printed on each package. I don't know if you understand what it means. Your name, you have a name. You are somebody. You are a mensch, a human being. Because those last 6 years we were numbers. When I arrived to Bochum, no one asked me my last name, my first name, my given name. Häftling. Häftling means in German prisoner. I am 7.5 years old. Looks like someone of 5 years old. No food, nothing. Prisoner, häftling. Number. 117030. This was my identity. Heaven, a number. And here, all of a sudden, we have a name. In spite of the name of the package, of the present, the same one, said Mrs. Vince, Paraminsova, we don't need their presence. We don't need their recognition. They kept silent 6 years. They didn't react when they killed our parents. We will not be there. She went out at the door. She said, boys, my last word, do it for me. And she went out. I was too young, hardly 8 years, to be involved in the consulate, but the boys had made a decision. Because of Mrs. Mintz, all of us will be there on time for our program. But to express our anger, to demonstrate our feelings, we will not cooperate with them. We will not give hands. We will not even look at them. that they come, these speeches around the world, no comment from us. We will not stand up, we sit on the grass. We don't lift up our heads to look at them. No photographs. If they want, they can photograph our bodies, not our face. In my home, there is an old newspaper from 1965, 50 years already ago. Paris Match. This is the name of the illustrated weekly magazine in France, Paris Match. The main article is a reportage, Le Val, Buchenwald, about the children of Buchenwald 20 years after the liberation, from 45 to 65. Two center pages is one picture. You see a lady, covered hair, stands near a microphone, speaking. Next to her on a bench, sitting few people, several, with uniform and civil. And from that stage, you see dozens of shaved heads. No one couple of eyes. No face, no nose, no mouth. Just shaved heads looking to the grass. This is the picture of Equi. The photographer took it. Mrs. Mintz made it very short. She introduced in Polish every one of the guests. They understood that they had no ears to listen to them. They made it even shorter. Everyone said almost the same. She translated from French to Polish. We are very happy to welcome you all here. We hope that you will be citizens and you prefer to stay in France, to be good citizens. France is open for you, open arms. We wish you success in life. After three, four speeches of this kind, this has been said. The last speaker will be Mr. Leibovich. I forgot the first name. 72 years ago. Mr. Leibovich, he said, is from my city, Lodz, in Poland. He's a survivor of Auschwitz. He lost there his wife and his children. He's the only one of his family who survived. Straight after the liberation of Auschwitz, on the 21st of January already, 45, 3 months before Buchenwald, Auschwitz was liberated by the Red Army, the Soviet Army. Mr. Leibovich came to France. He didn't go back to Poland, he knew that no one is waiting for him there. In France he had a factory of textile before the war. He wanted to know if something is there. He was surprised to find out that the factory exists, it works, and the general director of the factory was very loyal to Leibovich, knowing that he is in the Holocaust, didn't know the details. All the profits of the factory he put in the bank on the name of Leibovich. When Leibovich arrived in 45, he was there 6 years. The man told him, this is your account. I go with you tomorrow morning to the bank. It's your money. I ask your forgiveness that one of the works you did, the uniform for some of the Gestapo, was made in our factory. Mr. Lebovich went to the bank and discovered that he's a very, very wealthy man, very wealthy. Only incomes, no expenses, 6 years. But he made a promise like a swear. I will not enjoy this money. I will dedicate all this money to orphanages of the Holocaust. Those orphanages will be like my own private kids. Leibovitz and Mrs. Mintz is one of the main sponsors of this sanatorium echoing. He wants to give you his blessings. All of a sudden, no one gave an order. 220 heads were lifted up spontaneously, looking with sympathy to that language. No reason to boycott him. No reason to demonstrate against him. He's one of us. He was very moved to come to Italy, especially at this particular moment, he stands at the microphone and sees faces and eyes looking at him with such an empathy that warms. He thought at the moment that some of his children are here among all the others, his own children. He was so moved, he couldn't say more than 3 words. I will never forget. In Yiddish, the first word was Kinder, Yiddish children. After a while, Teile Kinder, dear children. And he broke out with cry. To listen in the microphone to a cry of an old man and a very unkind. Mrs. Mintz stood up on the bench, took him in his arm, and we could hear she told him in Polish, language, you made your speech already. Please relax. Sit here next to me. And here happened the miracle. Echoey became, for a while, a valley of tears. Every one of us felt, all of a sudden, that his face, his cheeks, become wet. And we didn't cry. We thought that as a cassetics, graduate of that university, Holocaust, of the cassette of the police, of the German, graduate of that school, we are adult enough not to cry, not to live here. It was a shame. But one of us broke out loudly. So no one could stop. And we started to cry open, free, loudly. 220 boys cried maybe 5 minutes, a long time. And everyone felt, much easier, much better now. We are free. And one of us, by the name Aharon, who was in the age of 20, stood up. This speech I will never forget in my last day. Even 72 years passed already. Aharon, if I didn't know his last name, was one of the elderly boys. He stood up and said, a poor Polish. Sofa, Mrs. Mintz, very honorable guests, friends. On behalf of my friends, even I didn't ask their permission, but I am sure that I will represent what they feel. I want to thank you for your visit. Not for the visit we didn't ask, not for the present we didn't want, but there is one present you gave us 5 minutes ago, and for that present we owe you great gratitude and thanks. The ability to cry is a great, great present. And I will explain you, he said. When they slaughtered my father in my very eyes, I was 16. I didn't cry. When I was beaten 25 beats by a mica, a gun made of rubber, I didn't give the Nazis the pleasure to see a Jewish boy cry. I prevented myself of crying. 6 years that I didn't laugh. The last 3 years I didn't cry. Since we were liberated 2 months ago in Buchenwald, every night before I fall asleep, I think to myself, Aaron, you have no future. You are a lost case. Aaron, no father, no mother, no relatives, no home. You are no more a human being. If you cannot smile, and if you cannot even leave a tear, maybe you have no more a heart of flesh and blood, but a stone. Maybe your heart became hard like a stone. If this is the situation, who will marry you? No one girl will take a husband who has a heart of stone. You will never have children. You will never have again a family. What the future expects you? These are my thoughts in the last 2 months. 5 minutes ago, I cried together with all my friends here on the grass. You gave me the ability, the chance, the present, to feel like a human being. I cry. And I know the secret, everyone knows. If I can cry today, I have a chance to laugh tomorrow. We are men, not robots, not stones, but human beings. Before I sit down on the grass, I want to tell you one word. Aaron said, every summer vacation, July, August, my parents used to send me from our shtetl to Varsha, where my grandfather used to live. He had a store, was a merchant. Because of July, August, and because of me, he closed his store early in the afternoon, took me in my hand, and went with me on a walk at the Wisla. Wisla is the greatest river which is crossing Poland from one edge to the other. We went near the Wisla on the bench, and my grandfather used to teach me the Bible. Favorite chapters of the Bible, the Tanakh, and some of them he insisted on that I will learn by heart. And a day later, in the afternoon, walking at the Wisla, he tested me. And I knew very many chapters by heart. Ladies and gentlemen, 6 years passed since I saw a Bible in my eyes. I didn't see. I forgot all the chapters that the grandfather told me, except one. One chapter I used to say in the camp, in the train, in the ghetto, 6 years, every night, I used to say the same chapter. Ezekiel the prophet, Yeheskel Ali, chapter 77. The hand of God was upon me. He said it in Hebrew, and then he translated in Polish, and put me to a valley. The valley was full with bones, very many bones, dry bones. And the Lord Almighty said to me, Mensch, Ben Adam, human being, Hatifiena Ha'atzamot Ha'ele, do these bones have a chance to live? And I said, the prophet answered, Atayadata, only you know the answer. A wind came, strong wind, and the bones came one to the other. And from the bones became corpses, hands, legs, heads, many, many corpses, but with no spirit of life. Ruach Eibar. He asked me again, no, now when you see corpses, not just bones, do they have a chance to live? I answered again, only you? No. Another wind blew, came in to these corpses. They stood up on their legs. A great, great battalion of people, living people, vivid, full of vitality. And then the Lord said to me, these dry bones are the symbol of the Jewish people. I have heard my people, Am Israel, saying, Avdat Ikvateinu, our hope is lost. Yavshu Atzmoteinu, our bones are dry. Nigzarmunam, we are cut off from life. I want to tell you, you have a mistake. I will open your graves, O my people, and I will lift you up out of your graves, my people, and I will bring you to the land of Israel. Hine ani potach et kivrotechem ami, hoceiti etchem mitoch kivrotechem ami, vehaveiti etchem el admat Israel. Aaron finished his speech, putting his hand on his heart and said, Madame Pinsova, Minsova, dear guests, friends, we are the dry bones. We thought that we are lost of life, no chance to hope. Here we, the Lord Almighty, opened the graves, took us out, and is leading us, now we are on our way to the land of Israel, 1945. I never forgot the speech, but I never met Aaron. I didn't know what happened to him, what is his last name, was one of 220. By the way, one of the other one of the 220 was Eddie Wiesel. Eli Wiesel was liberated with me together in Bochabad on the same day, of course, came with us to Egoin, and about the decision where to go from Egoin, the majority went to Israel, the Jewish agency before the establishment of the state of Israel, 3 years before the state. Some went to America, they have relatives here. Eli stayed in France. for 11 years. Only in 1956, he had immigrated from France to the United States, to New York. In my book, there is a preface from Elie Wiesel. I didn't know what happened to his arm. It was Elie and you, but he was very famous. And we are in touch all the time. I am the chairman of Yad Vashem Council. Elie Wiesel, let his memory be blessed, till his last day a year ago, he was the deputy chairman of Yad Vashem Council. And we were together in Bova and together in Equi. But from there, we separated. I mean, to Israel, he to America, France. I jump now to the Intifada, over 20 years ago. Once upon a day, 1:50 p.m., Spado restaurant in Yerushalayim, Jaffa, corner King George. A suicide, terrorist, committed suicide by killing himself and other 15 victims, Jewish victims. Eating lunch, the summer vacation, August. Among the 15 was a family of 3 children, father and mother. The name of their family, Schevesholder. Moti Schevesholder, the father, made Aliyah from the Netherlands, from Holland. That's the name, Schevesholder. His father was the head of Aguda, Agudat Israel in Holland. He himself married a girl from Natalia. I officiated the wedding. The wedding took place in Tel Aviv, and they had 8 children. 3 of their children were killed together with them. Another 2, Leale, 12 years old, and Chayale, 8 years old, hardly injured in the Bikur Cholim Hospital near the Sparrow restaurant. I met in the hospital of Shari Tzedek a girl from Melbourne, Australia, who spent the summer vacation in Yerushalayim. She was also injured, brought to the hospital. I asked her what is the last thing she remembers. She said, next to us was a table of a family, many children. When we have heard the bomb and we saw the fire, we didn't know what happened yet. The last one before I lost consciousness was that the father of that family next to my table said, Yeladim, children, say with me, Shema Yisrael. And he said, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, together the whole family. And then, since then I don't remember anything. This was the Moti Mordechai Schevesholder. That week I went as usual to the hospitals to visit the injured. In Hadassah Ein Karem, I went into the emergency room. Very hard injured people there were. And 4 professors joined me at this visit to explain me the situation of each of the people there. Who has a chance, who will come out, but how? With legs, with no legs, on a wheelchair, not wheelchair, scratches, hands, arms, blind, everyone his story. But they didn't tell me the whole truth, because in the injury, in the room, were some of the relatives. The professor didn't want the relatives to know exactly the situation. I gave my prayers, say Mishaber to each of them. And I went out. So you must remember Sori Eliyav from the Western Wall. Sori's daughter, 15 years old, was one of the hard injured in Hadassah in that room. And Sori was there sitting saying Tehillim. I went out with the professors to the corridor, and then they gave me the whole information about the daughter of Sori. They said she will recover completely. She will go out from the hospital on her own legs, with no wheelchair, she will be okay. I jumped back to the room, took Sori, and said in whispering to him, Michal will be okay. Don't worry, just time and patience. Be a hero, she will recover fully. And I ask you a favor. To her wedding, don't forget to send me an invitation. I officiated the wedding of Michal Eliyav in Binyanei Auma in Yerushalayim. Few years later. When we stand, the four professors and me, in the very narrow corridor, I hear the voice of an adult man behind me. Slicha, excuse me. Can I pass here? Ani yachol lavor po? Give me way. We didn't know who asked, but what a matter does it make. We went to the walls, three on this side, two on that side, and the man passed. While passing us, he looked back and said, Harav Lau? I said, Ken, yes. Shalom. Ani Aaron. After 50 years. I said, Aaron of Equi? Said, Ken, Aaron of Equi. I wasn't still sure. I said, Aaron of the dry bones? The Atzavot HaYerishon? Started to cry, and he left us. The four professors, I remember them by names, Durst, Shapira, Gotteswald, and Slavin, all the four said to me, how do you know Aaron? He said, how do you know Aaron? They said, he's the chief accountant of the Hadassah Hospital. He keeps on his shoulders the whole hospital. He pays our salary. A great head. But what is equi? What is the dry bones? I told them the whole story in the record, in the standing in the corridor. The one eye was dry. Then I thought to him, now I had the name, the professor's. I asked him, Aaron, what is his last name? He said, Landsberg. I looked at the telephone guide of Yerushalayim in the evening. Landsberg, Aaron, Yerushalayim. I phoned to him. He said, I follow you many, many years. Newspapers, radio, television, everything. I didn't want to disturb you, so I never applied to you. I knew that he would be a great man, but I didn't expect that Lulek from Chabad liberated with me, and we came together on the same boat, an Austrian shipment boat, Matarua, to Haifa. I didn't want to bother you because who am I? You are so busy, you are a great man. Do you remember the dry bones? What means if I remember? I can quote your speech word by word. At that time I knew Polish and I understood every word. Today this speech I wouldn't understand. because I forgot my language. But I didn't forget the man, I didn't forget the message. Then on the telephone he said to me, this chapter of the prophet Ezekiel kept me in life. Only this. It kept me alive. One chapter. 6 years alone, a boy, and then hell, the dark tunnel. 6 years, suffering, frozen, beaten. But the story of the dry bones that will come up out of the grave and will be on their way to the land of Israel, this gave me the hope and this kept me. Which reminds me far away from the May 3, the 3rd of May, 1989, 28 years ago, I was already Cheif Rabbi of Tel Aviv. There was still the Iron Curtain, Russia, not only Russia, the Soviet Union, 15 republics, Soviet Union. For the Israelis, it was an Iron Curtain. We couldn't come, and they couldn't come. But then came the perestroika, the glasnost. It was still Soviet Union. Gorbachev was the president. He opened a little bit the door. And he wanted to show a smiley face to the West. What did he do? He has invited a delegation, officially delegation, of 6 rabbis to visit Moskva and Leningrad, which is today St. Petersburg. That time was still Leningrad. To show them that there is Jewish life, there is a synagogue, there are even some rabbis there, Rabbi Shayevich in Moskva, Rabbi Levitatz in Leningrad. We came to Moscow. On the 1st of May we came to Leningrad. On May the 7th we came to Moscow for 6 days. And then there is a different, a very poor district there, poverty district, called Marina Roshcha. Today is a huge building there. But 1989, was a hat made of wood. This was the shoe of some old people and very young students, nothing in the middle. The old people, they kept a picture of the Lubavitch Rebbe on the wall. Said, does it belong to Lubavitch? Said, Mir seine Lubavitch Rebbe. The old people. And the young students, they are Jewish and they want to know what it means to be a Jew. So they come here from time to time, they study here. The Rosh Hashiva there is a girl, a converted Jew. Avraham ben Avraham Prokharovsky. And they are Lubavitch. It was Rosh Chodesh Iyar, May the 7th, you can check the books, 89, Tavshin Mentet. They asked me, I was the Cheif Rabbi of Tel Aviv already, to be the Chazan, Shachetz with Hallel. I saw on the column of the Kenter of the Baal Fina, instead of Da lifnei mi ata omed, or Shiviti Hashem benegdi tamid, I saw 4 words from the Psalms. Ana Hashem, Malta Nafshi. Please save my soul. I never sight. I know a little bit the Jewish world. From Helsinki to Melbourne, and from Hong Kong to Los Angeles. But I never saw in a shul where the chazan stands this word, please God, save my soul, Anna Hashem, Matan Hashem. The oldest guy there, I asked him, why do you put it? It's possible. It's very simple. The communism came in 1917. No religion, no Jewishness. You are comrades of the Communist Party. We are all one, all the same. And they forbidden everything. But Lenin, the leader, Ilyich Lenin, saw in the poverty district, Marina, Russia, a shul made of wood. He said, let them pray there. There are some old Jews, let them there. But no Shabbat, no Brit Milah, no Shechita, slaughter, kosher, no kashrut, nothing of this kind. Let a few old people down in their old shoes. We put it here, we put it, to say, they can control our bodies. They can send us to death. They can exile us to Siberia. But the soul is not under their control. We control our Jewish souls. Ana Hashem, Maltan Nafshi. Goofy, my body is in their hands. If they want, I die today. But my soul is eternal, is immortal in the hands of the Lord. This is the old Lubavitcher concept. That's what he understood. The Rebbe here in Crown Heights understood what no one that time knew, that we have to keep a contact with the people, our brothers and sisters, behind the Iron Curtain, and don't let this candle to be extinguished. This was his aim. And I made my book, the first book is practically Judaism. I made it in Russia for the practitioner Judaism. And the first chapter of my book, in a leather cover with golden letters, I dedicated to the Rebbe of Lubavitch. And it's written in Kvot Kedushat Admor Milubavitch Shlita. Let him live for a long life. And I brought it to him Sunday morning. I said, why me? The first exemplar. I said, because if not you, Rebbe, I wouldn't have any other reason for whom to print my book in Russian language. We owe it to you that there are still Yid there who know that they are Jewish and know what it means to be a Jew. One chapter of Ezekiel can save the life of Aaron Goldsberg, 6 years. This is the power of our tradition. This is the power of the Jewish heritage. So take for the Holocaust this message, not just Am Yisrael Chai, our immortality, our eternity depends on our continuity. Our continuity is the shul, and this is cool. Here in school, like this. Here, we are obliged for the future of our nation, the children who come here to learn what it means to be a Jew, and they go in the spirit of the Rebbe, the spirit of the prophets, they can assure us that Am Yisrael Chai Mikayam.
Thank you so much, Rabbi Lau, for your very meaningful and inspiring words. Thank you so much. On behalf of Chabad of the Shore, I want to thank Rabbi Lau. I want to thank all of you for coming. I just want to leave you with one message. The way Rabbi Lau finished his speech, we all heard Rabbi Lau's words, we read his book, we heard his story. We, our generation, has the greatest responsibility, not only to remember, not only to talk about what happened, but most importantly, inspire the future generations with Yiddishkeit, Jewish values, love of tradition. There's only one response to what happened 70 years ago. And the only one response that counts is to make sure that what they wanted to accomplish, that we should not be here tonight in a yeshiva, in a Jewish place. The only way they do not succeed, we stay involved in Jewish life, stay involved in the community, a kosher home, Shabbos, Jewish education, lighting Shabbos candles, putting on tefillin. My friends, all of Jewish history is counting on all of us to make sure that we have a future. Have a good night. Please stay for dessert. Thank you so much.
Good to see you. How's everything?